It used to be clearer. Predators ate herbivores. Herbivores ate plants. It was simple. But at some point, nature failed. This is what happens when the food chain is broken. It's not chaos, it's war. Let's go. Okay, let me show you this right away. This plant ate a bird.
Ending up as breakfast, lunch, and dinner for this carnivorous plant.
At first, I thought it was just an accident. You know, maybe the bird fell asleep and fell into the flower. Just wasn't its day or something. I don't know. But then I saw this. Okay. Lizards as well? What's next, a cow? I agree, a cow is too much, but birds and lizards are actually part of the diet of some carnivorous plants. And these aren't some small insects like flies, bugs, and ants. The bird is just huge for this flower. Plus, it's made up of meat, bones, feathers, after all. How can you even digest all that if you're a plant? Yes, evolution really worked hard. About 70 to 80 million years ago, when dinosaurs were still on the Earth, some plants began to lack nutrients. Maybe the sun wasn't shining right. Maybe the humidity dropped. But the fact remains that in order to survive in the changed conditions, they had to change as well. Apparently, they looked at some Tyrannosaurus and thought, that's the idea, folks. Through complex changes in DNA and the genome, plants gradually began to consume living organisms. You could say they consciously chose the life of predators and learned how to hunt. For example, the genus Nepenthes secrete a sweet nectar that attracts victims. They slip and fall into a pitcher trap with a digestive liquid at the bottom. It's impossible to get out of there. Sundews, on the contrary, catch their prey when it lands on their leaves and gets stuck in a sticky substance with special enzymes. The leaf with the prey then closes and opens again only when digestion is over. Some plants are simply huge. A Nepenthes raja trap can hold 0.9 gallons of water and more than 0.6 gallons of digestive liquid. At the same time, the size of bladderwort's trap usually ranges from 0.007 inches to 0.4 inches. But if everything is more or less clear with hunting insects, what about lizards and birds? Usually, they don't want to eat nectar at all, but smaller prey already floating in the trap. Well, bad idea. For a carnivorous plant, a large prey is a real treat. Lizards have a lot more nutrients than flies, but it's not that simple. If there's too much food, the plant simply can't digest it or at least spit it out. The rotting process will begin and most likely end in death. Wait, am I getting it right? These plants once wanted to become carnivores, so they just started killing animals, taking the prey from other predators. It was that simple? Imagine someone came to your house and was like, "Hey everybody, I live here now. Where's the fridge?" Honestly, it looks like the behavior of about half of my friends. Anyway, it's not natural to be hospitable to those who eat your food. Nature's harsh. If you fail to get something to eat today, starve to death tomorrow, and become someone else's dinner yourself. And so, while some animals, birds and insects, have simply resigned themselves to the fact that there's a new predator on Earth, others have decided to fight for their prey. Wolf spiders weave their webs on the same level as sundews usually do, and they prey on the same insects. That's why, when close to a competitor, spiders build larger webs away from plants, presumably in order to catch more food than the leaves of the sundew. It's not a matter of greed. Well, or not only that. The less food an enemy gets, the more likely it is to die. Now imagine for a second that the plants don't stop there. Their diet is already quite varied. Insects, lizards, birds, so maybe humans too. Okay, that's just the writer's fantasies. Well, mine too, a little, at least for now. But who knows, what if the evolution of plants is happening right now, literally before our eyes? We just don't notice it because we imagine them bright, tropical, unusual. And at this very time, blackberries seem to be starting to hunt sheep. It's most likely happening by accident. The sheep are just planning to munch on the leaves, but at some point they cling to the thorns with their thick fur and, like some flies, get stuck for good.
Yes, you silly yo, you're stuck. You're bramble stuck.
They can't get out of the blackberry trap by themselves, and if you've stroked a sheep at least once, you can understand why. All that remains for the poor creatures is to bleat miserably for a while in the hope of rescue and then, well, just come to terms with reality and accept a slow death from starvation, dehydration, or predators. But what does the bush get out of it? One theory is that the remains of the sheep serve as excellent fertilizer. Although the blackberry hardly thinks about it, I think it's just growing and doesn't know that it's undermining the usual food chains with its existence. Although if all those things with the blackberry seem quite logical, then the thistle, seriously, why do you need a bird? It's stuck on, what are you gonna do with it? Bait bigger birds and catch them, or animals? You're a thistle. This kind of hunting looks very creepy and very strange at the same time. But look here. If I'd shown this video at the beginning, you would have thought the elephant was just freaking out or fooling around, but actually, who knows? Maybe it knows a lot more about plants than we do, and it feels that they're up to something. Actually, elephants are incredibly powerful animals. They can crush trees and lift logs with their trunks alone, not to mention other parts of their bodies that can be used as well. Confronting an elephant when you're just a plant seems completely unrealistic. Also, elephants feed on fruits, branches, and foliage, and when they can't reach it, they just break the tree. On the one hand, that's pretty cruel, but on the other, what are they supposed to do? Look for a stepladder? What can you do? Wildlife is cruel. And when you're a plant surrounded by herbivores, it's slim pickings. Unless one day you hack the whole system and recruit insects. As they say, all's fair in war. African acacias have figured out that they can feed the ants nectar and provide them with a home near their thorns, and the ants in turn will protect the trees from elephants. Ants? From the elephants? Really? But elephant size played a dirty trick on them. When you're huge and clumsy, you just don't stand a chance in battle against 90,000 tiny biting creatures. Even the tough skin doesn't save you. Ants bite where it's thinnest. Get into the trunk, into the eyes, penetrate all the sensitive areas. No wonder elephants avoid acacias. You'd do the same if you were them. I'll be honest, I always thought plants were something very simple. Far from the cunning, intelligence, and taming of ants, but when you consider everything I've just told you about, how smart are they really? They've learned to defend themselves against elephants, hunt small and medium-sized animals, and according to a 2018 study, plants can also sense when they're being eaten. Not in the sense that they feel pain, of course, it can't be experienced without pain receptors, but plants in their own way are aware when someone, for example, starts chewing off the edge of their leaf, looking at how exactly the information spreads along the stem and leaves, you start thinking about the nervous system. And maybe there's a brain, too. Who knows? In reality, it's biologically impossible to meet a plant that's even slightly intelligent. Well, unless you're trying to get to school in a flying Ford Anglia, in which case the odds increase dramatically. Actually, the idea that there's an entire tree somewhere that isn't at all happy about people has been around for a long time. The earliest known account of the man-eating tree originated as literary fiction, written by Edmund Spenser in 1874. The descriptions were, of course, peculiar. Well, it was the 19th century, after all. There were other versions, but it all came down to one thing. There's a tree somewhere, one touch of which can be fatal. Well, who could imagine something like that, huh? Wait, what? Don't touch. This tree is very poisonous. What? If you think people can write any kind of things, I agree with you. But that's about how cars that have been exposed to manchineal tree sap look like. What'll happen to the animals? Yes, manchineal is considered one of the most poisonous plants on the planet. All parts of the tree contain strong toxins, literally, all parts. Its bark, leaves, branches, roots, fruits, even hiding under manchineal tree in bad weather is a very bad idea. A drop of rain mixed with the toxin is enough to make any living creature very, very sick. And no matter who becomes the victim, the result will be the same.
About 3 weeks ago, a visiting family in the Pigeon Point area ate the fruit from the manchineal tree and was hospitalized. The manchineal tree is poisonous.
Good thing the manchineal can't move and grab those who pass by. On the one hand, you could say that this plant has been so successful in its war on animals that it's even slightly overdoing it. Still, there's a species that doesn't care about poison. The Iguana Tenosaura similis not only likes to settle in the roots of the manchineal tree, but also eats its fruit. That feeling of not giving up and evolving to the last, animals one, plants zero. But if you look at the big picture, how far has this invasion of the animal world by plants gone? Have they succeeded in carving out a niche for themselves? A new place in the food chain? Well, what I can tell you, according to 2020 data, about a quarter of all predatory plant species are threatened with extinction. It seems that a war of tens of millions of years may end in an animal victory. Maybe the point is that the invaders are supposed to lose. Many predatory plants today have become pets. People keep them on their windowsills, showing off to their guests.
Is that what you wanted? Did you fight for this?
or they just seem to be losing and it's a distraction. This is nature. Anything can happen here. Today, the animals win. Tomorrow, the plants. And the day after tomorrow, man improves the Hadron Collider and everyone dies. The end. However, maybe the carnivorous plants should go back to their default settings and become normal again, before it's too late. Nice. See you later.